Today's session is going to be on intercellular connections and communication. So for a first year student, this is a very important topic, both in your theory exam as well as in your Viva Voice. And also we keep frequently asking some MCQs also in this topic. It's a very easy topic. Let's move on with the class. Okay, so this is going to be my lecture overview. What are we going to see today? We will look at the definition and classification of various junctions, like your occluding junction. We will look at the communicating junctions, and we look at anchoring junctions. And then we will touch upon cell adhesion molecule, what are its types, and then finally we will end the class with intercellular communication. Okay, so we will see one after the other. So coming to the definition of cell junction, what is a cell junction? A cell junction is nothing but, it is as the name indicates, it is a connection between one cell to its neighboring cell, or we can also say it is a contact between the cell and the extracellular matrix. Both applies to a cell junction. So by cell junction, we mean either it is a connection between two neighboring cells, or it is a contact between the cell and the extracellular matrix. So what is another name for cell junction? It is also called as membrane junction. So this is a point for MCQ. Cell junctions are also known as membrane junction. Now coming to the classification, cell junctions are classified into three types. One, occluding junction. Second, communicating junctions. And third, we have anchoring junctions. So what are these occluding junctions? Cell junctions which basically prevent intercellular exchange of substances are called as occluding junctions. One such occluding junction is your tight junction. Okay. So tight junction is basically a type of occluding junction. Again, this comes as MCQ. They'll give you many options and then they'll ask you to pick up under what type it comes. Okay. So tight junction is a type of occluding junction. It is the intercellular. So what is the definition of tight junction? It is the intercellular occluding junction that prevents the passage of large molecules. Tight junction is also called as zonular occludence. Cell junction was also called as membrane junction. Tight junction is also known as zonular occludence. So basically, it is an intercellular occluding junction. What you see here is a tight junction. Okay. So this is the tight junction here in between two cells. So it is an intercellular occluding junction. So it, as the name indicates, it is occluding. Occluding means closing. Since it is occluding or blocking, it is not going to allow the passage of large molecules. So usually it is seen in the region where the cell membrane of adjacent cells fuse firmly together. Most of the times it is present at the apical margins of the cell. Example, it is mainly seen in the apical margins of your epithelial and endothelial cells of the intestinal mucosa, walls of the renal tubule, capillary wall and choroid plexus. So what are all the places where we can see a tight junction? The apical margins of the endothelial and epithelial cells present in the intestinal mucosa, walls of the renal tubules, capillary wall and also in the choroid plexus. So now coming to the structure of the tight junction. So from the previous figure you will still remember, and also here you can see it is made up of ridge, which has two halves. So this is the ridge what you see here. This ridge is having two halves. One half belongs to one cell and the other half belongs to the other cell. So between two cells, we have the occluding junction or your tight junction. This tight junction is basically made up of ridges which fuse with one another. So one half of the ridge is from cell one, other half of the ridge is from cell two. Both the half of the ridges will fuse with each other very tightly and it will occupy the space between these cells. Clear? Now, what are these ridges made up of? Two types of proteins. One is integral proteins, the other is peripheral membrane proteins. So, two types of proteins make this tight junction. Integral protein and peripheral proteins. These integral proteins are also known as tight junction membrane proteins. Very common examples are occludin, claudin and junctional adhesion molecule. All these three are proteins that form the ridges of your tight junctions. And these proteins belong to the subcategory of integral membrane proteins. And then we have the peripheral membrane proteins, which is usually made up of singulin, symplin, and Zo 1, 2, and 3. Clear? So that is with the structure of tight junction. Now we'll go to the functions. So before going to the functions, I just want to recap again what we saw. We are having three different types of junctions: occluding junctions, communicating junctions, and anchoring junctions. By occluding junction, what do we mean? Usually these are the junctions which prevent intercellular exchange of substances. Those are called as occluding junctions. A type of occluding junction is a tight junction. So what is this basically? It is an intercellular upbeam junction that is going to prevent the passage of larger molecules. That is the definition of tight junction. Tight junction, structurally, it is made up of ridges which are basically protein in nature. So these ridges are formed by both integral membrane proteins as well as peripheral membrane proteins. Both peripheral membrane proteins and integral membrane proteins, both of them together form the ridges. So what are all the integral membrane proteins that help in forming the ridges? Occludin, claudin, and junctional adhesion molecules. What are the peripheral membrane proteins that help in forming the ridges? Singulin, symplin, and Zo 1, 2, and 3. These are all important MCQ questions. Little confusing, you have to memorize it. Now coming to the function. So we saw the definition of tight junction. We saw the structure of tight junction. What are the proteins that make up the tight junction? Now we are moving on to the functions of tight junction. What is the function of tight junctions? First function, the most important. What does it do? It has only selective permeability. It only allows certain smaller molecules and it forms a total barrier for larger molecules. Okay, so we know where is it present. It is present in the epithelial and endothelial cells, apical margins of epithelial and endothelial cells of your renal tubules, intestines, etc. So now what does it do? It acts as a semi-permeable diffusion barrier between neighboring cells. So it will only selectively allow certain substances and it will block all the larger molecule. Because of the selective permeability function, it is also called as gate function or barrier function. So what is the use of this? Because of this barrier function, the cells helps regulate the exchange of ions, water, and a variety of other molecules between the cell. Then the next function of a tight junction is it provides strength and stability to the cell. These are tight junctions which holds the neighboring cells of the tissues very firmly. Thus, it is also providing strength and stability to the tissue. It has a function called as fencing function. What is this fencing function? Because these cells are tightly adhered to one another, it prevents the lateral movement. It prevents the lateral movement of proteins and lipids which is present in the cell membrane. We know the cell membrane is made up of lipid bilayer. So now because of these tight junctions only, these proteins doesn't move. They are all, it prevents the lateral movement of the protein and lipid and they are held in place. This is called as fencing function, preventing the lateral movement of the protein and lipid molecules. Because of this fencing function, the tight junctions are able to maintain the polarity of the cell. Okay, so the fourth point is, fourth function of a tight junction is maintenance of cellular polarity. So fencing function of the tight junction maintains the cellular polarity by keeping the proteins in the apical region of the cell membrane. If the fencing function is lost, then the cell polarity will also be lost. Then finally, most important, it forms the blood-brain barrier. Tight junctions in the brain capillary forms the blood-brain barrier, which prevents the entrance of many substances from the capillary blood into the brain tissue. Only lipid-soluble substances like drug and steroid hormone can pass through this blood-brain barrier. Now coming to the applied aspects. Diseases caused by mutations of gene encoding for tight junctions can result in following diseases like hereditary deafness, acanthosis, that is scaly skin, sclerosing cholangitis, that is inflammation of our bile duct which causes obstruction, hereditary hypomagnesemia, that is low level of magnesium in the blood, and also synovial carcinoma. So synovial carcinoma is a soft tissue cancer. Functions of these tight junctions, not only dysfunction in tight junctions, mainly because of mutations of the gene encoding for the proteins. Sometimes certain bacterial and viral infections can also cause disruption of your tight junction. Clear? So that was with tight junction. So when you get this question in your exam, it usually comes as a 5-mark question. If you go about this, you will be able to score good marks and you will not forget your important points. You have to write down the definition and then structure and functions. Finally, end the note with the applied aspects. Now we will move on to the second classification of junctions. Occluding junctions are over. Now we are moving on to communicating junctions. What is a communicating junction? Cell junction, as the name indicates, the cell junction which permits the interchange of substances between cells are called as communicating junctions. These junctions permit the movement of ions and molecule from one cell to the other. We have, under communicating junctions, you have gap junctions. So what is a gap junction? Gap junction is an intercellular junction that allows the passage of ions and smaller molecules between these cells. It is also called as nexus. Another type of communicating junction is a chemical synapse. Chemical synapse is also a type of communicating junction. So what does a gap junction do? It allows the passage of ions and smaller molecules between cells. Where is it present? It is present in the heart, basal part of the epithelial cells of the intestinal mucosa. If you remember, occluding junctions were always present at the apical margin. Communicating junctions are present in the basal part of the cell. Now coming to the structure of gap junction. The membranes of two adjacent cells lie very close to each other and the intercellular space is reduced. Okay. So this is a gap junction. The intercellular space between two cells is reduced around 2 to 3 nanometer. The cytoplasm of two cells is connected by the channel which is formed by membrane of both cells. So now a channel is formed. So the cytoplasm from cell 1 can easily move and pass through cell through this channel without having any contact with the extracellular fluid. So contents from the cell, one cell can go into another cell without coming in contact with the extracellular matrix. Each channel consists of two halves. Each half, just like our occluding junction, each half belongs to one of the two adjacent cells. So here you can see two halves. One half is belonging to cell 1, the other half is belonging to cell 2. Each half of the channel is usually each of this half. Each half of this complete thing is a channel. Each half of the channel is surrounded by 6 subunits of proteins called as connexins or connexions. You have to put a chart and note down what is a protein that is making up gap junction. What is a protein that is making up a tight junction? There is some overlapping, but otherwise you should not get confused between these. So coming to the functions of gap junction. Since we are already saw, the diameter of the gap junction is reduced. So the channel will only permit passage of substances like glucose, amino acids and ions and other substances which is having a molecular weight of less than 1000. Then only, otherwise they will be too large to pass through this narrow gap of 1.5 to 3 nanometer. It also helps in the exchange of chemical messengers between the cells. Another very important function, especially in the heart, it helps in rapid propagation of action potential from one cell to another cell. Here we have to, when coming, looking at the function, we have to see how is this diameter regulated by the gap junction. Basically, it is the intracellular calcium ion concentration that regulates this diameter of your gap junction. Whenever the concentration of intracellular calcium ion increases, the protein subunits of this connexin, 6 subunits are there, 6 protein subunits form each half of the gap junction. So now when the intracellular calcium ion level increases, the protein subunits of these connexins surrounding the channel come very close to each other sliding, thus reducing the space and pulling the cells close towards each other. Then another type of communicating junction is chemical synapse. So let's see what is a chemical synapse. A chemical synapse is nothing but junction between a nerve fiber and a muscle fiber, or a junction between two nerve fibers through which signals are transmitted by means of release of a chemical transmitter. Okay, example, neuromuscular junction, acetylcholine is the chemical transmitter which is getting released. So chemical synapse is nothing but a junction. Synapse is basically a junction between a nerve fiber, between two nerve fibers, or between a nerve fiber and a muscle fiber, and signal from one part of the synapse to another part of the synapse reaches through the help of a chemical messenger. And coming to the upright physiology, mutations and this chemical synapse we already saw in detail in the earlier class, physiology of synapse. So now coming to the applied aspects, mutations in the gene encoding for connections are going to cause diseases again, such as deafness, keratoderma, that is thickening of the skin on the palms and soles, cataract, opacity of the lens in the eyes, peripheral neuropathy, that is damage to the nerves of the peripheral nervous system, Charcot-Marie disease, a form of neuropathy, and heterotaxia, that is abnormal arrangement of organs or parts of the body in relation to left and right symmetry. So all these diseases are caused whenever there is mutation in genes encoding for connections, that is whenever the gap junctions are not properly formed. Now we will move on to our third type of junction, that is anchoring junction. So from the name itself, you can easily derive the definition. First, we saw occluding junction, which doesn't allow larger molecules to pass through. Then we saw gap junctions, where substances are passing from one cell to the other. Then we are substances are action potential. Then now we have anchoring junctions. So anchoring junctions are nothing but junctions which provides strength to the cells by acting like mechanical adjustments. Anchoring, it is attaching, so that it gives mechanical stability to these cells. So anchoring junction is responsible for the structural integrity of the tissue and are present in the tissues like heart muscle, epidermis of the skin. Why? Because these are the places where it is subjected to very severe mechanical stress. All those regions in the body which is subjected to severe mechanical stress, we will find anchoring junctions, most commonly in heart tissues and epidermis of the skin. So how is it formed? There is a firm attachment. All this what you see here are anchoring junctions, different types of anchoring junctions. So there is a firm attachment between two cells or between a cell and the extracellular matrix that is provided. This attachment is provided either by actin filaments or intermediate filaments. So basically, anchoring junctions are nothing but which helps the cell to anchor on to another cell or attach to the extracellular matrix. What is the function of these anchoring junctions? They provide structural integrity to the cell. Where are they commonly seen? All those areas which are subjected to severe mechanical stress, commonly the epidermis of the skin, heart, etc. Now, how are they attached? As I told you, it is attached to the next cell or it is attached to the adjoining extracellular matrix. The attachment can be through either actin filaments or through intermediate filaments. If the attachment is through actin filaments, we have two types of junction. Based on the type of filament which forms these anchoring junctions, we have four different types. If actin filament is involved, then we have adherent junction and focal adhesion. If intermediate filaments are involved, then what we have is desmosome and hemidesmosome. Adherent junction is basically between cell to cell. Adherent junctions is formed by actin filament, and the anchoring or attachment is between one cell and the other. Focal adhesion is formed by, again, actin filament, but the attachment is between the cell and extracellular matrix. Now, desmosome. What is a desmosome? Desmosome is similar to your adherence junctions. It is just only difference is it is formed by intermediate filament. Hemidesmosome is similar to focal adhesion, but it is formed by intermediate filament, not actin. So, based on this figure, you can know that we have four different types of anchoring junctions. So, we will see each of this in detail. So, first is adherence junction. So, what is it already from the previous slide? You know, adherence junction is between one cell and the other cell. And the filament which makes up adherence junction is nothing but actin filaments. So, it connects the actin filament of one cell to that of the another cell. Where is it present? In the epithelial linings. It forms a continuous adhesion just below the tight junctions. The membrane of adjacent cells are held together by a transmembrane protein called as cadherins. This provides strong mechanical adjustment to the adjacent cell. It is present in the intercalated disc between the branches of a cardiac muscle. During contraction and relaxation of the heart, the cardiac muscle fibers are held together tightly by means of these adherence junctions. So, adherence junction present in the epidermis of the skin also helps to withstand the mechanical stress. Okay. So, just to recap, what are adherence junctions? Adherence junctions are nothing but anchoring junctions that are formed by attaching the actin filaments from one cell to the other. The proteins involved in this are called as cadherins, and mostly these adherent junctions are present in the epidermis of the skin and in the intercalated disc of the heart muscle. Helps in withstanding severe mechanical stress. Then comes focal adhesions. So this is a focal adhesions what we are seeing here. Focal adhesion is the anchoring junction that is formed between a cell and the matrix. Again, the connection is through the actin filaments. The transmembrane proteins which makes up focal adhesions are integrins. The transmembrane proteins which makes up adherent junctions are cadherins. Here it is integrins. Then desmosome. Desmosome is similar to adherent junctions. It is a cell-to-cell junction where intermediate filaments are connected between both the cells. The desmosome is also called as macula adherens. The membrane of the two adjacent cells which oppose each other are thickened and becomes spot-like patches. When we look in under electron microscopy, it looks like spot-like patches. Desmosome function is similar to that of tight junction. So it is only going to have selectively, it will allow certain substance to pass through it. Again, the proteins which make up desmosome is cadherins. Hemidesmosome is similar to focal adhesion molecule. So, the proteins that make up hemidesmosomes are integrins. It is very similar to focal adhesion. Only difference is the connection is formed by intermediate filament and not actin filaments. Why is it called hemidesmosome? Because half desmosome is in the cell. And then the remaining is in the extracellular. One half is formed by the these adherent junctions and the other half is in the extracellular matrix. So, this is a hemidesmosome or half desmosome. Applied aspects. Any dysfunction of adherent junctions and focal junction results in colon cancer. And this is the reason for tumor metastasis also. And dysfunctions of desmosome leads in bullous pemphigoid. That is, it's an autoimmune disease which stems blistering on the skin. Patients of these diseases will usually develop antibodies against cadherins. And dysfunction of hemidesmosome also causes bullous pemphigoid. Here we can see antibodies against integrins. So that was with our types of cell junctions. Now we will also look at cell adhesion molecule. All these junctions are formed, basically formed by these very commonly asked 5-mark question recently. What are CAMs? CAMs are nothing but cell adhesion molecules. These are the protein molecules that is responsible for attachment of the cell to the neighboring cells or to the basal lamina. They help in structural organization of the tissues. So what are the various types of cell adhesion molecules? Just now, whatever we saw, when you put everything together, you get this. Cadherins, which form the molecular limbs between the neighboring cells. Usually, adherin junctions and desmosomes are formed of cadherins. Integrins, which form focal adhesion and hemidesmosomes. Then IgG superfamily, which form cell adhesion molecules in the nervous system. And selectins, which act as receptors or ligand for carbohydrates, and they are also found in platelets and endothelial cells. That is with the cell adhesion molecules. Basically, these are protein molecules which helps in attachment of the cell to one another or to its matrix. So here we have a complete summary of whatever we saw today. What is the type of junction? What are the proteins involved in these junctions? What is the function and example? Let's very fast go through this once. So first type of junction is a tight junction. The proteins involved in tight junctions are occludin, claudin, JAMs, junctional adhesion molecules, singulin, simcalin, ZO 1, 2 and 3. Basic functions of a tight junction is to provide strength and stability to the cell, selective permeability, gate function, fencing function, maintenance of cellular polarity and formation of blood-brain barrier. Where is it seen? Epithelial lining of the intestinal mucosa and renal tubule, endothelium in the capillary walls and choroid plexus, usually found at the apical margins. Then comes gap junction. Gap junction is basically made up of connections. It allows, as the name indicates, it allows passage of small molecules and ions and chemical messengers. And also it helps in quick propagation of action potential, found in the epithelial lining of the heart and intestine. Then comes adherent junctions, made up of cadherins. It helps in cell-to-cell attachment, found in the epithelial lining of heart and epidermis, regions which have high mechanical stress. Then focal adhesions, they are made up of integrins. They help in attachment of the cell to the basal lamina or the extracellular matrix, usually the epithelial lining of various tissues. Desmosome, the protein involved is cadherins. Desmosome helps in cell-to-cell attachment and it is present in the epithelial lining of the skin. Hemidesmosome is made up of integrins and it helps in attachment of the cell to the basal lamina or extracellular matrix and it is present in the epithelial lining. Clear? Very, very simple. From the name, you can arrive the functions. Especially the last four. Adherent junctions, focal adhesion, desmosome and hemidesmosome. They are all similar. Only thing is the protein that is involved is different. Now finally, we will see what are this intercellular communication. Sorry for the spelling mistake. Intercellular communication. So this intercellular communication is cells of the body must communicate with each other to coordinate the proper functioning of the various organ systems. So this communication can take place either through cell signaling or through these physical contact between cells, that is either directly or indirectly. Directly, it takes place communication, that is cells are communicating between one another either directly or indirectly. Directly through gap junctions and surface markers, direct linkage with the surface markers. Indirectly through chemical messengers or signaling molecules, that is very, very specific to the target cells. So now coming to the chemical messengers, the cell signaling is through by means of four ways. Chemical messengers, basically first we have to see what are chemical messengers. Chemical messengers are substances that is involved in cell signaling by release of a chemical substance. All these chemical messengers carry out their message or their signal from the signaling cell to the target cell. The messenger substance may be a hormone or a hormone-like substance. Based on this, we have four different types of chemical messengers: endocrine, paracrine, autocrine, and neurocrine. So what do you mean by paracrine? These are local chemical messengers. The signaling cell or the controlling cell is releasing it, and the chemicals will go and exert their effort on the neighboring cell, which is there in their immediate environment, the cell which is lying very close to it, and it will bring about its action. Neurotransmitters, they travel through a short range. Neurotransmitters are also chemical messengers which travel through a short range. It diffuses across a narrow space to act locally on the adjoining cell. The adjoining cell could be either a neuron or a muscle or a gland. So here what we see is a paracrine signaling. This is a secreting cell. The chemical messengers are secreted, and then this goes and attaches to the local target cell, which is lying very next to it. This is neurotransmitter. So at the terminal ending, the neurotransmitter vesicle with the neurotransmitter is released, and then it travels through a short distance and goes and attaches to the receptor of the target cell. Then hormones. Hormones are long range messengers. They are secreted into the blood by ductless glands called endocrine glands in response to an appropriate signal. Once they are secreted, they travel long distances in the blood, go and attach to the target cell and bring about its biological effect. Neurohormones are usually hormones that is released in the bloodstream by neurosecretory neurons, and they are again bring about their action just like a endocrine hormones. So what you are seeing is the hormonal secretion. That is, the endocrine cell is releasing its content, releasing the hormone into the bloodstream. It is traveling and then comes and attaches on the specific target cell that has a receptor for it, and it brings about the biological function. So on the non-target cell, the non-target cell will not have the specific receptor, so the hormone is not going to attach there. So chemical messengers, as I told you, they are responsible for primarily bringing up the communication between two cells. So how do they bring about their effect? Primarily by signal transduction. That is, incoming signals are conveyed into the target cell's interior by either forming first messengers or second messengers. So this causes, once binding up of the chemical substances to the receptor is either going to cause opening up of closing up of channels in case of like chemically gated receptors, or by activating second messenger system. That is, first it activates the first messenger. First messenger relays the information into the cell. The intracellular proteins inside the cell will carry out the dictated messages. The examples of second messengers are G-protein coupled receptors and protein kinase activity. So here again, we have a different types of chemical messengers. What we see here is endocrine, which we just now saw. Autocrine. Autocrine means the cell which is releasing the molecule. This substance, chemical substance, the substance is going to act on the same cell and bring about its action. That is called as autocrine. Autocrine messengers are chemical messengers that controls the source cell from which they have been secreted. Paracrine, we just saw, it is going to diffuse from the signaling cell. The molecule is going to diffuse and then reach the target cell, which is very, very close by. Then we have another one called as paracrine. Okay, now coming to the examples of hormones, you know, growth hormone for endocrine. For autocrine, mainly leukotrienes. This is how leukotrienes are acting. Now coming to our paracrine messengers, very common examples of paracrine are like prostaglandins and histamines, which are getting released. And then we have another one called as justacrine messengers, or paracrine or justacrine messenger, where the signaling molecule is diffusing to the target cell through a gap junction. When the messenger diffuses through a gap junction, then we call it as paracrine or justacrine. And then neurocrine messenger, through neurotransmitter, we already know neurotransmitter diffuses through the synaptic cleft and then brings about its action. And then neurocrine messenger, neurohormone, is one where the substance is released from the neuron, travels through the bloodstream, and then brings about its effect just like endocrine. Neurohormone is nothing but a chemical substance that is released by the nerve cell directly into the bloodstream and then transported to different target cells. Example, this is how your oxytocin, antidiuretic hormones are all getting released and brings about its function. I hope today's class was useful and you would have gained some knowledge. If you have any doubts, you can ask me or leave in the chat window. I'll be more than happy to answer your doubts. Thank you. And I thank Dr. Balaji for giving me this opportunity.